Welcome to the Arizona Deliverance Center. You guys ready for God's Word?
Yeah.
Okay. Let's put on a song before we get into God's Word. I wasn't sure whether I wanted to do that or not. Let's put on number two, if you can, brother. We'll listen to a song and just invite the Holy Ghost to just bless us tonight. And then we'll get into a message tonight. It's titled Weapons of Our Warfare. So tonight I want to just discuss the weapons that God has given us for warfare. Amen. But let's listen to this song here and get blessed.
We have seen the way you move.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Full of goodness, full of mercy.
You guys can get uncomfortable if you like. Shout, you can pray, you can worship, stand, lift up holy hands,
oh God of
whatever you feel led to do, amen. Thank you, Lord. I'll just pray. Thank you, Father. We thank you for tonight. Have your way in this place. Bless your people tonight, Jesus. Thank you. Thank you for the people of God in the house of God tonight. Hallelujah. They came. They need a miracle. They need your presence tonight, Lord.
And your kindness overwhelms. As you see,
thank you, Lord. For wherever two or three are gathered together in my name, I am there in the midst of them, saying Jesus. Thank you, Lord. He's here tonight. He's going to speak to us tonight. He's going to bless us, heal us. Change us. Transformation. Blessings. Deliverance. Quicken our bodies. Amen. Romans chapter 8, verse 11. But if the spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his spirit that dwelleth in you. Thank you, Lord. Come on, give my hand clap. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Have your way in this place. Shut that down. Thank you, Lord. You guys have a Bible tonight? Any Bibles in the house? Yeah. Or a device, whatever you're using to look at Scripture. This sounds a little crazy, but you can shut that music down too, brother. We're going to go ahead and get started. Tonight, once again, weapons of our warfare in 2 Corinthians chapter 10. Verses 3 through 5. This is the Apostle Paul writing to the church in Corinth. There's an echo. So he says, the Bible says, "For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Jesus Christ." I love that scripture. That's powerful. And so what Paul is basically encouraging the church there is that, we're in a war. Amen? When you got born again, you joined a spiritual war. Hallelujah. When you made that decision to follow Jesus, you were making that decision that, yeah, I'm gonna enter this war, but I know I'm winning. Hallelujah. I'm going to enter this war, but I know that I'm going to win this war because my king already won already, and I'm rolling and I'm riding with Jesus. And because Jesus won, I win. Because Jesus won, you're going to win. Come on, say it tonight. Say, we already won.
We already won.
Yes, we already won. Hallelujah. The devil's already been defeated. Now we just get the. Now we just have to fight, do our part, and see the obtain the victory. But he says we're not warring after the flesh. Then he says the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty. So he's telling us that we have weapons. God has given you weapons to do warfare. Is that what he's saying?
Yes, sir.
Right? Did you know that? Did you know that God has given you weapons to battle? Weapons for warfare. So tonight we're going to just discuss what are those weapons? What are they? I believe that the weapons that God has given us are His Word, the blood of the Lamb, the name of Jesus and the divine dunamis power of the Holy Ghost. Amen? So we're going to get into that. So let's pray. Father, thank you for tonight. Thank you for the church of the living God in the house tonight. Lord, I pray that you would reveal Jesus. My prayer is that they would leave here never changed and not the same. My prayer, Lord, is that you would touch them and speak to them, that you would encounter them tonight, that they would be encouraged, that they would leave here happy, knowing that Jesus is for them and with them and living inside of them. And I pray this in Jesus' name. The church said, amen. So every believer should focus. I believe every believer should focus and obtain these 4 points as a Christian. Number one, we need to know God in an intimate way. Our whole life needs to be about knowing Jesus. That should be the priority of our lives. That should be the focus of our lives. That should be the goal of our lives. That's my mentality. It's Jesus. Amen. My mentality, my attitude, my mind frame is Jesus. More of Jesus. Daily. I want more of you, Lord. I want to know you more. What are you saying today, Lord? What do you want me to do today, Lord? I practice the presence of Jesus. Amen. We practice the presence of Jesus on a daily basis by faith, regardless of how you feel or what's coming against you or what the symptom may be or what the natural circumstance is. We practice the presence of Jesus on a daily basis. We know that we know that we know that we know by faith that he is with us, that he is with you. Better yet, that he lives in you. Is that true? Hallelujah. So number one, to know God, without a sincere, intimate relationship with King Jesus, you don't have a chance against the enemy. Is that true? Number two, to find freedom. All of us have been wounded, hurt from past sins that were committed against us. We deal with bad thinking. We have emotional issues, traumas. Number two is we obtain freedom. We find freedom. Amen. We glorify Jesus with our life. And number three, find your purpose. Find your purpose in the local church and use the spiritual gifts God has given you. Hallelujah. God has given you gifts. Find your purpose and obtain the call of God, the will of God. Number four, we have to make a difference. We're not just called to pay bills and work a 9-to-5 job. We're called to walk in victory and to be the victorious church of Jesus. Amen? Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 57, but thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Are you guys thankful? Thanks be to God who gives us the victory. God has given you the victory through Jesus Christ. You're obtaining the victory in Jesus. Amen? Whatever's wrong right now, I know there's situations and circumstances and trials and tribulations, but you, nevertheless, right now, you are in a process of obtaining the victory because God has given it to you through the Lord Jesus Christ and what he did for you. Amen? So I believe with all my heart that Paul wrote 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 through 5, to destroy strongholds. And to tell the church, you know, we need to destroy the strongholds. So how many of us know that Paul was writing to Christians? Right? He was writing to Christians in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 through 5. He's writing to Christians and he's telling Christians, you need to destroy those strongholds. You need to destroy those lies you've been believing. And you need to renew your mind. He's talking to Christians, okay? And so how many of us know that applies to us today in 2018? We need to destroy those strongholds with the weapons God has given us, and we need to focus on renewing our mind. God has already done his part. We have to do our part. Say it tonight. Say, I need to do my part. We do our part, amen. God wants us to be strategic, prepared, self-controlled, passionate, hungry, word-minded, Christ-minded, Holy Ghost-minded, love-minded, disciples that are ready to overcome when the devil attacks our mind. Because how many of us know that the poor devil is not going to give up? He's going to attack your mind. Let's just be honest. He's going to attack your mind, and he's going to try to bring up your past and sins that you committed and lies and sins that were committed against you and things that you did. He's trying to keep you focused on the past. Jesus said we must continue in his word before we can know the truth. Mind renewal comes by the truth. And those who want a quick fix don't continue in the truth. Those who want a quick fix and don't continue in the truth never see freedom. That's true, isn't it? Those that want a quick fix, those that aren't in God's word, those that aren't committed to God's word, determined to be in God's word, you're going to meditate on the word of God. You're going to read the Bible on a daily basis, not legally. Not legalism, but because you want to be in God's word. You want to renew your mind. You know that you must renew your mind. You made a decision that you're going to have a new attitude, a new mentality, a new mind frame, a new belief system. Those who want a quick fix don't continue in the truth, and they never see freedom. God wants to train us, amen? God wants to train you in the truth. And he wants to teach you how to fight. He wants you to learn how to fight so that we can help other people. Amen? You are called to renew your mind and for God to do a glorious work in your soul, in your life, and then so that God can use you to help somebody else, amen? You're a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Regardless of how old you are, or what you do for a living, you're called to be a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Are you a believer? Yes, these signs shall follow them that believe. Amen? Signs are going to follow you. Signs are going to follow your ministry. That's your ministry. That's what you're called to do, to be a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ, to obtain your freedom, and then help somebody else. Amen? Are you guys excited? Jesus said in John 8, 31 and 32, if you continue in my word, then are ye my disciples, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Amen. So we need to continue in his word. Then we're his disciples. If we continue in his word, then we're going to know the truth, right? We're going to know who Jesus is. We're going to know what Jesus did for us. We're going to know what Jesus said about us. We're going to know what Jesus said about himself. We're going to know what Jesus said about the devil being defeated. Amen. The truth, we're going to receive that truth. We're going to know the truth, and then comes freedom. You got to be open to that truth. You got to be teachable. You got to be ready. You got to want the truth. You got to be tired of the lies of the devil. Are you mad at the devil? Are you tired of his lies? Because if you're going to compromise and be lazy and be passive, well, then you're going to just agree with the devil. And you're going to think like the devil, and you're going to talk like the devil, and you're going to act like the devil. But if you'll get angry and you'll decide, you know what, devil, you're a liar, you are defeated, and Jesus was right about you. He said you're the father of lies. Yeah. And you'll obtain that truth, and you'll say, you'll call on the King of Truth. And you'll have that intimate relationship with the Spirit of Truth. You'll be changed. You'll be transformed. You're going to know that truth, and the truth shall make you what?
Free.
Come on. Hallelujah. When you renew your mind, you find God's will for your life. Many Christians are born again, but they have never found the perfect will of God, because they never presented their bodies as a living sacrifice. You guys know where I'm going with this, right? You know what scripture I'm going to? Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. But the unrenewed mind cannot find the will of God. The unrenewed mind cannot find the will of God. It's only when the mind is renewed that we find God's special plan for our lives. Look at Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. This is the Apostle Paul preaching. He said, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. That is us tonight, amen? We need to present our bodies as a living sacrifice to the living God on the altar of God. You're going to say, God, I know that I'm alive, but I am crucified with Christ. God, I want to give you my life, Jesus. I'm going to stop living for myself. I'm going to stop being selfish. I'm going to stop being proud. I'm going to stop being self-absorbed. Amen. You're going to lay your life down on the altar of God, and then that's when you can truly renew the mind. Right? That's what Paul's laying out here. He said, "I beseech you to lay your present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God." Then he goes on to say, "Be not conformed to this world, be ye transformed by the renewal of your mind." Hallelujah. That's good, isn't it? I love that. What's the first step? Lay your life down, right? You got Jesus said that he that finds his life shall lose it, but he that loses this life for my sake shall find it. You need to lose that old life, that old man. You're a new creation. You're a new man now. If you're born again, you're a new creation. You're a new man. You're a new species. We're a new race. Is what that means. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things are become new. You're a new race. You're God's new race. You're the new creation. You're the church of the living God, and you're a new person. Lay your life down on the altar of God. Then you're going to be able to be transformed by the renewal of your mind. Then when you renew your mind, then you're going to be able to prove what is that good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. Who wants that perfect will of God? Yeah. Amen. I want God's perfect will for my life. Yes, I know it's not going to be easy. I know it's going to be difficult. I know it's going to be tough. I know I got to make some tough decisions in life. But it's going to be worth it. It's going to be glorious. It's going to be awesome and mighty. And King Jesus is with me. And he said that he has a perfect will for your life available to you. If the devil can get you thinking negatively about God, he has the upper hand. The first recorded words of the devil in the Bible are, "Did God really say?" Right? Who did he say that to? He said it to Eve, remember? Did God really say, "You must not eat any of the fruit in the garden"? God is not a negative God. He is full of grace, mercy, and love. But Satan wanted Eve to think of God as being severe. He wanted her to believe that God was cruel and harsh. Jesus warns us about the enemy, about his lies. Jesus called the devil a liar and a murderer. And Christians should understand this fact, that the devil wants to bring death to you. He wants to murder your purity. He wants to kill your joy. And he wants to destroy your spiritual life. We can overcome the enemy's lies. We are overcoming strongholds. Amen. That's what we're talking about tonight. Weapons of our warfare to overcome, to destroy strongholds. And there's no turning back in the Christian life. Either we live completely for Christ or we fall into the traps of the devil. Amen. I want to encourage you guys tonight to never, ever, ever give up in the process of renewing your mind. Look at Psalm 63:8. I love what King David said here. Psalm 63:8. Write these down put a note in your device and meditate on the scripture tonight. Psalm 63:8, King David said, "My soul followeth hard after thee." I love that. That literally means, in the Hebrew, it means to cling, to stick, to stay close, to cleave, to keep close, to stick with, to follow closely. Amen. We need to stick close to and follow closely the Christ. Amen. The resurrected Christ. We need to pray. We need to pursue Jesus like never before. In prayer, in his word, in worship. Hallelujah. Is that exciting to you? Yeah. Amen. So he said, "My soul followeth hard after thee." Look at what happens to you when your soul follows hard after Jesus. This is what's going to happen. King David said, "Thy right hand upholdeth me." When you follow hard after Jesus, his right hand is going to uphold you. Who's the right hand of God? The Holy Ghost. He's going to uphold you. He's going to bless you. He's going to heal you. He's going to change you. You're going to be transformed. You're becoming a new creation. You're becoming a new man because you decided that you're not going to be that old person anymore. You decided to put your past behind you. You decided that you are a new man, a new creation, and you made a decision that you're going to pursue and follow hard after the resurrected Christ. Amen? And you're never going to be the same. You're going to overcome, and you're not going to be the same. You're being changed. You're in a process of transformation daily, minute by minute. You're being transfigured and transformed by the love and the power of God because you decided to follow Jesus. Through his word, through prayer, through worship, through evangelism. Look at Hebrews 11:15. Here, I believe Paul wrote the book of Hebrews, and here Paul is saying, he's talking about the Jews in the Old Testament, and he's talking about, the verse says, "And truly, if they had called to mind that country from which they had come out, they would have had opportunity to return." So he's talking about how when the Jews came out of Egypt. And so what that's saying to us is that if you're gonna focus on your past, if you're gonna call to mind your past, you might just return. Let me read that again. "Truly, if they had called to mind that country from which they had come out, they would have had opportunity to return." Okay? So called to mind there literally means to remember, to call to mind, to think of and feel, to hold in memory. We need to put our past behind us. Hallelujah. But we need to. Can I just tell you tonight that God has forgotten your sin?
Yes, sir.
Does the Bible say that? Yes, hallelujah. In the book of Hebrews, it talks about that their iniquity and their lawlessness, I will remember no more. We should not be focused on our past. We should not be dwelling on the past. We need to look. I love what Paul said. "Brethren, I count myself to have apprehended, but there's one thing I do. Forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before. I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus." Amen. That is you tonight. That is us. We're going to do that one thing. We're going to forget those things which are behind. I'm forgetting that heroin addiction. Hallelujah. From 8 years ago. I'm forgetting that cocaine bondage and how much money I spent on cocaine. I'm forgetting that bondage of alcoholism and perversion. I'm forgetting that bondage of living under witchcraft curses and poverty and demon lies and hatred and rejection and worry and anxiety. That is the past. I have forgotten that. God has forgotten my sins. I'm the new creation. I'm pursuing Jesus. I'm not going to be the same. Hallelujah. I'll never be the same. I'm pursuing a resurrected Christ. Amen. He's guiding me. He's leading me. He's healing me. He's speaking to me. He's touching me. He's blessing me. He's helping me. I got the great eternal helper, the Holy Ghost, living in me. That's not being proud. That's just being honest. Amen. God says he lives in me. God lives in you. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Romans 8:11. John chapter 14, verses 12 through 14. Amen. God resides in you, in your spirit, man, in the church. Look at Hebrews 12:2-3. Again, Paul said, "Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith." We need to look unto Jesus. Amen. You know, when you see Jesus, you're never going to be the same. Amen. Come on, give Jesus a hand clap. Thank you, Lord. When you see Jesus, you'll never be the same. When you see Jesus, your life will be changed forevermore. When you have that Christ encounter and Jesus reveals himself to you, You'll have so much joy. Yes. Hallelujah. So much joy pouring out of your belly. Rivers of living water. You'll be changed when you see Jesus. But Paul's saying here, looking unto Jesus, that literally means in the Greek, to turn the eyes away from other things and fix them on something. We need to turn our eyes away from what the enemy has to say. Turn your eyes away from what the enemy is doing. Turn your eyes away from the lies of the enemy. Turn your lies away from the past. Turn your lies away from that natural circumstance, that natural storm trying to crash against your life. And fix your eyes on Jesus and his word. My eyes are fixed on His word. And what He says about me. And what He did for me. My eyes, my spiritual eyes are fixed on Jesus. On who He is. Let's get into these weapons here. Number one is the number one weapon is speaking God's word. We have to speak the word of God. Psalm chapter 107:20, the Bible says, He sent His word and healed them and delivered them from their destructions. God's word, when you speak the word of God, that's going to be an amazing weapon in your life for you to overcome strongholds, for you to overcome lies. You have to be strategic. You have to be a soldier and a warrior, and you have to be determined to say, you know what, I'm going to study the word of God. I'm going to read the word of God. I'm going to meditate on the word of God, and then I'm going to speak the word of God. The Bible is not just meant to be read quietly for 5 minutes. Amen. It's a lifestyle. You're submitted to the word of God. You submit to the word. And then you're going to speak the word. Memorize the word. Be a doer of the word. Amen. We need the weapon of the word to overcome. To study His word, to memorize it, we need to fall in love with His word. To act on the word. Without an intimate relationship with Jesus through His word, we're easily deceived. Amen? That's why James 1:22 says, be ye doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. I don't want to be deceived. Amen? You don't want to be deceived. We submit to the word and then we're doers of the word. One of the most dangerous habits Christians make is treating the word as though it were a common book. The word takes the place of the absent Christ. The disciples had Christ. We have the Holy Ghost and His word. Amen? We need to give the word the same place we would give Christ if He were physically in our presence. Hebrews 4:12, the Bible says, for the word of God is quick and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing in the division of soul and spirit, and of joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. The word of God is quick and powerful, and that word is going to be used on your mouth. Amen. I want to challenge you that if you don't practice that, you know, add that to your arsenal, add that to your lifestyle as a Christian, to speaking the word of God. Amen. Take some scripture that you want to meditate on, or maybe you want to memorize it. Or maybe you're struggling with something and your answer is in that scripture. Take that scripture. You might even laminate. I got God's word laminated here. You get that word, you laminate, you keep it in front of you, amen? And you speak it. Speak that word daily, amen? Speak His word daily over your life, over your health, over your mind, over your future, over your ministry, over your children, over your money. You're going to prosper. Isaiah 55:11. So shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereto I sent it. Your life is going to prosper because you're speaking the word of God over your life. Is that true? Paul told the early church in Ephesians chapter 6, verses 16 and 17. Jot that down, write that down. Look at verse 16. Paul said, above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith you shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. Okay, what are the fiery darts of the wicked? Lies, strongholds, right? Tactics, deception. So, the shield of faith is simply aligning yourself with God's truth. The shield of faith in your life is going to be that you're going to align your soul. You're going to align your life. You're going to align your ministry. You're going to align everything about you with God's word. That is your shield of faith. Amen. Verse 17, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. That Greek word for word there is rhema. In other words, it said, which is the rhema of God. And that simply means what one has said, or an utterance, okay? So it's God's word spoken is what the rhema of God is. And so you're going to take God's word and you're going to speak it in your circumstance, amen? Look at Mark. What Jesus said in Mark 11:23. Mark 11:23, Jesus said, whoever says unto this mountain, be thou removed and be thou cast into the sea, and does not doubt it in his heart, but believes those things he says will come to pass, he will have whatever he, what? Whatever he says. Amen. Whatever you say, you're going to speak boldly. You're going to speak the word of God, and you're going to have what you say. Amen. You're going to speak to the mountain. You're going to speak to that demon mountain standing against, coming against you, coming against the promises of God. And you're going to say, you demonic mountain, in the name of Jesus, you have to move. You will get out of my way. Amen. You will get out of my destiny. In Jesus' name, I command you to get out of the way of my destiny. Get out of the way of God's perfect will for my life. But you're going to have to speak to it, though. I can't speak to your mountain for you. I mean, I could, but the Bible is instructing us to for you individually to speak to your mountain. To not have to rely on somebody else to do it for you. Amen? The church shouldn't have to seek out and search out and travel or find some an evangelist or a televangelist or somebody that's supposedly anointed. You are anointed. You are a believer. You are powerful. You are called. You are chosen by the resurrected Christ. And he's given you authority to speak to the mountain. Whoever says unto this mountain, be thou removed. Amen. Did he say whoever prays? In this situation, I mean, I love prayer. And I believe it's great to pray. But right here, Jesus is saying, you don't have to pray. I want you to speak to that mountain. Boldly and command that mountain to go. Amen. Are you going to do it?
Yes.
Hallelujah. Look at Hebrews 13:5-6. What the writer of Hebrews said. If it wasn't Paul. I believe it was Paul. That's another topic though. But Hebrews 13:5-6. The Bible says, let your conduct be without covetousness. Be content with such things as you have. For he himself has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. So we may boldly say, the Lord is my helper. I will not fear. What can man do to me? He's encouraging us to say some mighty things, some powerful things, to speak the word of God. Amen. God has placed his word on your mouth. Your mouth is now a weapon in the kingdom. Say it tonight. Say, my mouth is a weapon in the kingdom. It's true. Look at Joshua chapter 1, verse 8. Jehovah told Joshua, the book of the law should not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in it day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success. Hallelujah. I love that. Because I want my life to be prosperous, and I want to have good success in my life. That means I need to meditate on God's word, and I need to speak the word of God. Because that's what he said, right? The word, the law, or the word, in our case, is not going to depart from your mouth. You're going to meditate on it. You're going to be a doer of it. Then you're going to prosper. Then you're going to have good success. Amen? Good success in your family. Good success in your body with your health. Good success financially. Is that true? Good success with your relationships. Good success with overcoming and conquering strongholds in the devil. Good success in ministry. You want to be successful? Hallelujah. You don't sound like it. Come on. Hallelujah. Yeah. Shout that word tonight. The devil hates that word. Say successful.
Successful.
Say it louder.
Successful.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Listen to Hannah's prayer. I love the story of Hannah. If you haven't heard about Hannah, she was barren. She, from the Old Testament in 1 Samuel 2:1, the Bible talks about Hannah, and so she didn't have any children. She was the enemy was attacking her. She couldn't have kids. But here in 1 Samuel 2:1, the Bible says, Hannah prayed and said. That's what we need to do, amen. We pray and we say. We pray, hallelujah. Be anxious for nothing, but with all prayer and supplication, let your requests be made known unto God, right? We come to God, we worship God, we pray, God, help me in this situation, Father. Lord, What can I do in this situation? Father, where are we going? Lord, you pray sincerely, hallelujah. And then you say, like Hannah did. Hannah prayed and said. We're going to do the same thing. We're going to pray and then we're going to say. And so look at what Hannah said. She said, my heart rejoiceth in the Lord. Mine horn is exalted in the Lord. My mouth hath been large over my enemies. I love that verse. She said her mouth was large over her enemies. Is your mouth large over your enemy? Because your enemy is trying to kill you. Your enemy is trying to steal, kill, and destroy. Your mouth needs to be large over the enemy. Quit being passive. Hallelujah. Quit being lazy. Quit procrastinating. And let your mouth be large over that rotten devil. Amen. Because he is defeated. Amen. He is defeated. You need to rise up and make that decision in your life and say, I know he's defeated because my Lord and Master and Savior died for me. Amen. He died for the church of the living God. And he, in Colossians chapter 2, verse 15, having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. I'm going to take that word and I'm going to act on that word. Your mouth needs to be large over your enemies, like Hannah. Amen. Are you ready for that? It's okay to get loud. It's okay to get loud. Amen. Say that tonight. Say, it's okay to get loud. You know, when Jesus confronted the devil in Matthew chapter 4, I guarantee you that Jesus didn't say this. Excuse me, Satan, but can you please get behind me? Hallelujah. No. I'm sure that Jesus shouted with a holy shout, get behind me, Satan! Yes. Amen? You can do the same thing. You're going to do the same thing. Jesus said, go, adversary. For it is written. Let's try that tonight. Say, go, adversary.
Go, adversary.
For it is written. That's what Jesus did. Amen? When Jesus raised Lazarus from the grave, Jesus got loud. If your divine master got loud, can I just tell you tonight, it's okay for you to get loud. Amen?
Amen.
If you're going to a church where they don't like it to be loud or like it to be loud or get loud, then you need to find a new church. Hallelujah.
All right.
If Jesus got loud, I'm going to get loud. The Bible says in John 11:43, these things saying with a loud voice, he cried out, Lazarus, come forth. How did Jesus fight the devil? With the word of God. Jesus simply said, it is written. That's your answer for the rest of your life. That is your answer for the rest of your life. It is written. In the Bible is where all your answers are. And whatever's in there, whatever's written there, that's what you got. Amen. The devil is going to bombard your mind and give you all kinds of excuses and reasons why you can't serve God and why you're not going to receive the promises of God. I'll say it again. The devil is going to bombard your mind with all kinds of lies and reasons why you can't serve God. And these days, everybody wants fantastic results with little effort. Is that true? That's what everybody wants. Great results with no effort, with hours on Facebook and hours on Netflix and Instagram. Amen? But we are the church of the living God. We're going to take God seriously. Hallelujah. So we cannot be lazy when it comes to the study and the speaking of the word of God. You cannot be afraid of entering into warfare. We cannot be so unprepared and so entangled with the affairs of this life. Because Paul said in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 4, and Paul was writing to Christians, and Paul said, no one engaged in warfare entangles himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who enlisted him as a what? As a soldier. You're a soldier. You've been enlisted into the end times army of the Lord Jesus Christ, and you are a soldier. And the Bible says, no one engaged in warfare entangles himself with the affairs of this life. That Greek word for warfare there is strachomai, which simply means a military expedition to lead soldiers to war or to battle, to be on active service as a soldier to fight. Amen? Okay, so what was the number one weapon that we just discussed?
Sword,
the sword, the spoken word, amen. Number two, quickly, is the, it's already 7:45. So quickly, number two is the blood of the Lamb. Redemption is buying someone back. And Jesus went into Satan's slave market and he bought us back. Hallelujah.
Amen.
In 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 19 and 20, the Bible says, Paul said, or do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God, and you are not your own, for ye are bought with a price. We have been bought with a price. The blood of the Lamb is going to give you boldness. Boldness to approach God righteous again. Boldness to put the enemy in his place. And boldness to overcome strongholds. And boldness to act on the word of God. Hebrews 10:19. I love what the scripture says. Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus. That's good. We conquer and overcome the enemy by the blood of Jesus. We live victorious lives now by the blood of the Lamb. And God Almighty has legally destroyed the devil by the blood of his Son, Jesus Christ. Hebrews 9:14. How much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, cleanse your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? Hallelujah. And so I believe with all my heart that what we're supposed to do to apply the blood is just testify about what the blood has done in our lives. Look at Revelation 12:11. The Bible says they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb. That's what God has done for us. Amen. God did his part already, didn't he? We have to do our part, right? So God's part was the shed blood from the cross of the Christ. Revelation 12:11, they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb. And now comes your part and the word of their testimony. Right? You need to add your testimony to what the blood of Christ has done for you individually. Is that true? Look at Psalm 107:2. The Bible says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom he has redeemed from the hand of the enemy. Right? We need to speak on what the blood has done for us. Does that get you excited? Is that true? It's a little quiet in here. Let's try it right now. Let's start right now. Let's discuss or let's testify what the word says the blood of Christ did for us. When you do that, I want to encourage you tonight that when you testify about what the blood has done for you, all of the spirit world is listening to you and you have a mighty confession of what the blood has done for you, and your high priest seated at the right hand of the Father is going to make it good in your life. Hallelujah. Come on. I'm more excited than you guys are. Hallelujah. Come on, somebody. When you speak on the blood of the Christ, your life is going to be radically changed, mightily, powerfully, because you're testifying about what the blood has done for you. You saying you're defeated devil, you sickness, you disease, you mountain of lies, by the blood of the Lamb, I was redeemed. Move out of my way. And what's going to happen? That mountain is going to move. That devil will be afraid of you. That devil will flee because you know what the blood has done for you. You believe it in your heart. You put your mouth into operation and you're acting on the word of God. You're a disciple now. You're a soldier. You're a warrior. And the Bible says that they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. So you strategically have a testimony about the blood of the Lamb. Amen.
Yes,
hallelujah. Let's do this right now. Amen. Shout this with me. Say, by the blood of Jesus, I am the righteousness of God.
By the blood of Jesus, I am the righteousness of God.
By the blood of Jesus, I am justified.
By the blood of Jesus, I am justified.
Just as if I had never sinned.
Just as if I had never sinned.
By the blood of Jesus, I am washed from all sin.
By the blood of Jesus, I am washed from all sin.
By the blood of Jesus, I am cleansed.
By the blood of the Lamb, I am complete in every good work.
By the precious blood of Jesus, I am redeemed from the curses.
By the blood of Jesus, I was redeemed from the hand of the enemy.
That's my testimony.
You hear me, devil.
You're in trouble. Hallelujah. Come, Jesus, a hand clap. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Praise God. That's going to be powerful in your life. Amen. Do that in your life. Add that weapon to your arsenal, the blood of the Lamb. You're going to testify what the blood has done for you. You're going to testify what the blood is doing for you. Amen.
Amen.
Weapon number three. What was number two? The blood of Jesus. Hallelujah. Number three is the name of the Christ. The name, the glorious name. Philippians chapter 2, verse 9. The Bible, Paul said, I love Paul.
Paul was amazing, wasn't he? Paul said, wherefore God also hath highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name. The highest name in the universe. Hallelujah. Praise God. Greater than the name of poverty and death and destruction and disease and demonic lies and cancer and heroin addiction and cocaine addiction and rejection and self-rejection and mental illness. Greater than lust, unbelief, and doubt. Amen. His name is awesome and great, greater than any other name in the universe. Joel 2:32, the Bible says, it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be delivered. We are children of the kingdom. Right? We are children of the kingdom. We have full authority. Jesus himself backs us. No demon or disease or circumstance can resist our command in the name of Jesus. They are all subject to the name. The name is majestic. The name above every name. The Father has willed it. The Holy Ghost bears witness to it. And countless lives since his death and resurrection give testimony that his name is a mighty name. Amen? Amen. Acts 2:21, the Bible says, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Romans 10:13, whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. All that Jesus was on the earth, his name is today. That name has lost none of the power of the man who bore that name. The Father has lifted him up to the highest position in the universe. And God gave him the highest name in the universe. Amen. Hallelujah. Yeah, give him a hand clap. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your mighty name. God bestowed honor and glory and power on the Christ and sat him down at his right hand. And because he's alive, we're alive. And John 20:31 says, these are written that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you might have life in his name. Hallelujah. Amen. That name will give you the victory over the enemy. Look at Luke 10:17. Here's a story of when the disciples went out and casted out demons and they came back. The Bible says the 70 returned again with joy, saying, Lord, even the devils are subject unto us through thy name. That applies to us as well. Amen. But we're not supposed to rejoice in that, though. We're supposed to rejoice that our names are written in the Lamb's book of life. Amen. Hallelujah. Look at John 14:12-17. Jesus said, verily I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works I do shall he also do. And greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father. And whatever you ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it. Is that powerful? Now we command the forces of darkness to become obedient to the authority of the name of Jesus Christ. That name has been given to you as a weapon to use his name. Jesus gave it to you to overcome and conquer. We need to give the name its real place in our lives. Like Peter did. Look at Acts 3:6. Peter said, silver and gold I do not have, but what I have I give thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And that crippled man jumped and rose up. Amen. And he started walking in the authority of the name of Jesus. At last, we are masters over evil. Hallelujah. You believe that? Yes. At last, we are masters over evil. I was with the ministry. I went to Tucson with the ministry team, I believe maybe like 3 weeks ago. And we went over there Brother Mike was preaching a powerful message. And then we just saw the kingdom of God destroy darkness. And we operated in the name of Jesus Christ over there. Amen. Amen. Every command we made was in the name of who? Jesus. Hallelujah. Say his name tonight. Come on, I want you to get uncomfortable. I want you to practice Jesus Christ. Jesus. Hallelujah. Your circumstances are going to change when you shout and you declare and you make a command in his name. You need to be aggressive with that name. You need to understand the power in that name, the authority that's been delegated into you in that name, and you need to use that name as a mighty weapon. We arise and take our place now in his name. The Holy Ghost enables you to use his name like a mighty warrior. As though Christ were again in the flesh, exercising divine power on a larger scale now. All power is in the name of the risen man, Jesus Christ, who is seated at the right hand of God. If you learn to use the name according to the word, in the power of the Spirit, you have the secret that shook the world with the early church. Amen? Is that true? Look at James 5, 14 and 15. The Bible says, is any sick among you? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up. Mark chapter 16, verse 17 and 18. These signs shall follow them that believe in my name, shall they cast out devils. So we need to appreciate, we need to know the power that is in the name. So what do we discuss so far? What were the three weapons we discussed so far? What was number one?
The word.
So, and we're going to close out and finish with number four, which is divine dunamis power in 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 and 4. I love the scripture where Peter writes, as his divine power has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness. Then he goes on to say, through the knowledge of him who called us by glory and virtue, by where have been given to us exceedingly great and precious promises, that by these you might become partakers of the divine nature. Hallelujah. God's divine power has given you all things that pertain to life and godliness. And he has made you a partaker of a divine nature. That is your identity. Amen. But it comes by God's power. Philippians 3:10, Paul said, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection. So that that word there for power is the Greek word dunamis. And what that means is, in the Greek, it's power to perform miracles. It means strength, power, and ability. It also means power and resources arising from numbers, right? We're the church, we're the end times church. We're coming against the enemy in numbers. We're not doing this alone. You're not doing this isolated. Hallelujah. You're not doing this on your own. We're doing this in numbers. It also means moral power, excellence of soul. So dunamis power opens blind eyes, opens deaf ears, makes the crippled whole, raises the dead. Demons come out of people by dunamis power. And so the woman with the issue of blood in the Gospels knew that if she could just touch the hem of his garment, she would receive that dunamis power and she would be made whole. Look at Mark chapter 5, verse 27 through 30. Let's look at that story quickly. She was sick for years. She spent all of her money trying to get healed. And the Bible says in verse 27, when she heard of Jesus, hallelujah. When you heard of Jesus, right? What about when you heard of Jesus? Amen. How many of us know that we got a faith coming by hearing and hearing by the word of God? So she heard of Jesus and came in the press behind and touched his garment. For she said, if I may touch but his clothes. What did she do? She said something, right? She put her mouth in an operation and she said, if I may touch but his clothes, I shall be whole. And straightway the fountain of her blood was dried up and she felt in her body that she was healed of that plague. And immediately Jesus, having known in himself that out of him power had gone forth, having turned up. So that word power there is dunamis. So that is the number four. The fourth weapon that we're getting into tonight, but it's just God's power in your life. God's power, you must receive the power of God in your life through the baptism of the Holy Ghost. You cannot overcome the enemy on your own willpower. You cannot overcome without the power of God in your life. How do we receive God's power? We simply ask for it. Amen. We simply ask for the power of God. And then we believe that God has given us his power by faith, and then we simply put our faith into action. Okay? Look at Acts chapter 1, verse 8. You shall receive power after the Holy Ghost comes upon you. Ephesians 3:16, Paul said that he may give to you according to the riches of his glory with might to be strengthened through his spirit in regard to the inner man. That's that Greek word again, dunamis, where it says with might. Colossians 1:11, in all might, being made mighty according to the power of his glory, to all endurance and long suffering with joy. So we need God's power in our lives, and that comes via the baptism of the Holy Ghost, and usually with the evidence of speaking in tongues. But we need to operate in the power of God. We need to pray in tongues. We need to receive those tongues. If you don't have them, we'll pray for that tonight. Amen. So why do we renew our mind? Why do we destroy the strongholds? Why are we engaged in warfare to fulfill the call of God in our lives? Do you agree? To fulfill the call of God in your life. The Apostle Paul was obedient to the heavenly calling. The Apostle Paul was a murderer. He's a religious persecutor of the church. But he got his call, amen. He got a call from Jesus Christ. And in Acts chapter 26, verse 18 and 19, this was his call. The Bible says in Acts 26, 18 and 19, Jesus speaking to Paul here says, to open their eyes and turn them from darkness to light and from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins, an inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith that is in me. And then Paul goes on to say, whereupon, O King Agrippa, I was not disobedient unto the heavenly vision. You have a heavenly vision. You have a holy calling. God has called you. Chosen. Many are called, but few are chosen. Many are called, but few make a choice. Will you make that choice to follow Jesus' heart, to renew your mind, to put your past behind you, to overcome strongholds? Will you make that choice? The call is the key to God's will for our lives. The greatest security, the greatest prosperity, the greatest peace, the greatest blessing, the greatest fulfillment, the greatest achievement, hallelujah, the greatest self-esteem, the greatest success comes in participating in God's work. Do you believe that? His will, His plan, hallelujah, it never fails. We're on His side. We run with Jesus. We never lose. Everything works out. We always win because we're following Jesus, Romans 8, 28, and we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them called according to purpose. You are called according to the purposes of God. Isaiah 6, 8. Then Isaiah said, then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send and who will go for us? Then said I, here am I, send me. Is that you? Yeah. Come on, give Jesus a hand. We're done tonight. Thank you, Lord. In closing, we have no reason to be afraid. Amen. Because we go in the name of Him who conquers all, Jesus. Tonight, let's activate these weapons that we were discussing. Hallelujah. Let's go ahead and play some of that music, brother. And every eye closed, every head bowed in this place. I've been shouting long enough. Father, I thank You, Lord, for this the church in the house tonight. Lord, have Your way tonight. Thank You, Jesus, that You're here. You have spoken to us. Hallelujah. Thank You, Lord. You have a plan for us. I pray for Your grace to be poured out in a mighty way. Your mercy, healing, dunamis, resurrection, power. The weapons we discussed tonight, God, Your word. I pray that the blood of the Lamb would be activated in our lives tonight. The name of Jesus be spoken tonight in a powerful way. And Your divine power in our lives. Thank You, Lord. Thank You, Lord, that You're here. Touch the body of Christ tonight, Jesus. Have Your way. Thank You, Lord. Thank You, Lord. Come on, just give Him thanks right now. Thank You, Jesus. We thank You. We love You, Lord. You are awesome in this place. You are mighty God. You are the everlasting Father. Come on, just exalt Jesus. You are the mighty Son of God. You are the Lion of Judah. You are the chief shepherd. You are the chief cornerstone. Hallelujah. You are the crucified one. You are the resurrected one. You are the light of the world. You are the King of glory. You are the King of kings. Hallelujah. You are Jesus Christ, Son of the living God. You have resurrected and ascended on high. You are seated at the right hand of the throne of the Father. You are here in the manifestation and the power and the presence of the Holy Ghost. Thank You. Come on, let's repent. We're gonna break these strongholds tonight. We're gonna overcome these strongholds by repenting for believing the enemy's lies. Hallelujah. We believed the enemy's lies. We invited him in, right? We said we committed sin, didn't we? Come on, let's not be proud. Let's be honest tonight. We committed sin. We invited that devil in to destroy our lives out of ignorance. We said, devil, come on in and destroy my life. But not anymore. Hallelujah. Not anymore. Now we're going to repent, and we're going to repent for believing those lies. Let's do it right now. Go ahead and leave that music where it's at, brother. Thank you. Hallelujah. If we're just simply going to repent for believing the lies of the enemy, your prayer might sound something like this. Father, in Jesus' name, I repent for believing all of the devil's lies. Father, by the blood of Jesus Christ, I ask you to wash me clean from every demonic lie, every stronghold that I gave entry to, that I gave place to. Wash me, cleanse me, heal me by your power. Your power is dunamis power. Your power causes my soul to be excellent. By your power, heal me. Heal my pain from believing those lies. Expose the devil behind those lies. Expose those entryways. Expose those bad memories. Expose those hurts. I release that pain to the cross. I release that hurt to the cross of the Christ. By your grace, expose every lie, expose every stronghold. Father, I forgive every person that hurt me, that caused those strongholds to be built, those castles, those fortresses in my mind. I forgive so-and-so for what he did to me when I was young, that caused me to believe that I was worthless. Go ahead, forgive those people that hurt you, maybe a family member molested you, took advantage of you, abused you, lied about you, verbally assaulted you, physically abused you, raped you. Whatever they did to you, it was the devil. Let's forgive that poor soul. Forgive that person. Release that person to the cross. And take that pain and release that pain to the man who bore it. To the man who bore that shame. To the man who bore those diseases, that pain, those curses. To the man Christ Jesus. The Bible says about Jesus in Galatians 3:13, Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. Jesus became a curse for you. Let's break that curse right now. Hallelujah. I say, by the blood of the Lamb,
by the blood of the Lamb,
I break every generational curse that was passed down
to
my family.
In
Jesus' name, by the finished work of the Christ, by the shed blood, I say I am redeemed from every curse. I say, you cursed mountain, you demonic mountain, on the authority of the name of Jesus, tonight you will move out of my way. You move out of my destiny. I will not be stopped. Because I go in the name of him who conquers all. Hallelujah. Every curse is broken now. In Jesus' mighty name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Come on, let's deal with those strongholds. Deal with any strongholds. Let's deal with any strongholds right now. Say, you demonic stronghold, you crumble, you fall, you release my mind. I break that band over my mind now in Jesus' name. You stronghold of fear, you stronghold of diseases, you perverted stronghold, I break your power. I renounce the authority I've given you, Satan. You release me by the fire of God. By the power of God. In Jesus' name. I say every stronghold will fall and crumble and be destroyed by the love of God, by the grace of God. Come on, renounce every agreement with the devil. Do that right now. Break every agreement with the devil right now. Devil, I break agreement. Devil, I renounce you. Devil, I hate you. Devil, you have no more rights. You are exposed. You demon, attack, you demonic influence. I break your power. I break agreements with those lies of the enemy. Satan, you cannot torment me anymore. Devil, you cannot have your way anymore. Devil, I break your power. I break that band on my mind. I break those demonic cords. I break that covenant. In Jesus' name. Come on, let's what do we do now? We're gonna speak the word. We're gonna say some powerful things. Say, on the authority of God's word, we are the church of the living God. I am the new creation. On the authority of Colossians chapter 1, verse 13. I have been delivered from the power of darkness and translated into the kingdom of Jesus Christ. You devil, take your filthy hands off my life and come out right now. Come on, cast that devil out. Command that devil to go. Command that devil to release you right now. You poor devil, you come out of him now. In Jesus' name, you release the body of Christ. You come out of him now in the name of Jesus. By the power of God, by the shed blood from the cross, devil, come out of them now. In Jesus' name, you have no right to stay. You cannot stay. Go ahead, dislodge that devil. Command that devil to come out of you. They're going to come out by a breath, whether you're coughing or burping or yawning. Come out. Come out of the body of Christ now. In Jesus' name, you defeated devil. I charge you now. Release them now. Come out of them now in Jesus' name. You devil causing bad memories and hurts, pain, come out of them now in Jesus' name. Curses, demonic curse, generational curses, come out of them now in Jesus' mighty name. In the name of Jesus Christ, you release the man of God. I break every chain. Go in Jesus' name. Come out of him in Jesus' name. Go in Jesus' name. Go in Jesus' name. Go in Jesus' name. Come out of him now. Dislodge. Take a deep breath or a burp or a cough or a yawn. Out. Come out of him now in Jesus' name. I break every generational curse of witchcraft that was passed down the ancestral line. I say go and come out, perversion. I say come out of him, torment. Out now in Jesus' mighty name. Go. Give me a good yawn or a cough. Out. Come out of him, devil. In the name of Jesus, I say go. You mountain of death. You mountain. You demon mountain. Go right now. Come out of him in Jesus' name. Come out of him in Jesus' name. By the love of God. By the power of God. In Jesus' name, go. 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 Now, come on. I break that covenant with hell. I break that commitment with the lies of the devil. You unclean devil behind those lies. I break your power right now. I charge you now. Release the man of God by the grace of God. Release the man of God in Jesus' name. There's freedom. I see a light. I see a new light. I see rivers of joy and passion coming back to your word, to your life. Hallelujah. I see dunamis resurrection power in operation in your life, in your ministry. Oroboshiko lobo sandro. Oroboshiko lobo bandro. La ba 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 ba. Listen to me, devil. I charge you to release him and come out right now. In Jesus' name. What's the name of that? What's the name of the enemy? What's coming against you?
Jezebel. Brother, say this. I found Jezebel in spirits above.
Say, I renounce all the authority.
I renounce all the authority
that was given to Satan.
That was given to Satan
through sexual sin.
Through sexual sin. Yes.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Devil, you are exposed.
You are exposed.
You cannot stay here anymore.
You cannot stay anymore.
You will release me right now.
You will release me right now.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Come out right now.
Come out in Jesus' name. Release me in the name of Jesus. Release me in Jesus' name. Release me by the fire of God, by the blood of Jesus.
Who hurt you? Who hurt you?
My wife.
Okay, what's her name?
Stephanie.
Say in Jesus' name.
Say in Jesus' name.
Father, I repent.
Father, I repent.
For what I did.
For what I did, Lord.
But I release her.
And I release her.
I forgive her.
I forgive her and I bless her, Father.
And Lord, I ask you to heal that situation.
So I ask you to heal
my heart in that area.
Heal my heart, Lord, in that area, Lord.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
You heard that, devil. You heard the man of God, Satan. You cannot use that against him anymore. In Jesus' name. Come out of him now. I break that spell. I break that witchcraft curse now. In Jesus' name. Come out of him, you rotten, defeated devil. I say, go right now. In the name of Jesus Christ, come out of him now. In Jesus' name, come out of him. In Jesus' name, come out of him. In Jesus' name, release him now. In Jesus' mighty name, release the man of God. Release the man of God. Release the man of God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Your breakthrough. This is your breakthrough tonight. You are, you're getting your breakthrough.
By the blood of Jesus.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. They're coming out. They're coming out. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, I command, I charge every unclean devil to release him right now. You come out of him. You have no right, you spirit spouse. You Jezebel, you Ahab. Ahab spirits, personality traits. Go in Jesus' mighty name. Come out of him. Come out of him now. Come out of him in Jesus' name. Say this, say, devil, I renounce you. I renounce darkness.
I renounce witchcraft.
You have no right to stay.
I
forgive myself. Father, cleanse me. I ask you to close every door to the enemy. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Father. You're doing it right now. Thank you for the children's bread. In Jesus' name. Listen to me, Satan. I command you to come out of me right now. You cannot stay. You cannot torment me anymore. You have no right. Go in Jesus' name. Come out of me in Jesus' name. Come out of me in Jesus' name.
Give me a good, there you go. There's a burp or a cough.
Out now in Jesus' mighty name. Come out of him in Jesus' name.
Come on, come here. Come up here.
You're getting that breakthrough, hallelujah, right now. You're getting it right now. In Jesus' mighty name, I renounce all darkness.
I renounce all darkness in Jesus' name.
All authority given to the enemy.
All authority given to the enemy.
Did you ever have your palm read? Or any kind of involvement with witchcraft?
By my grandma and my great-grandma, dad's side were witches. My mom couldn't have children. Okay. She had my brother, and then she was having miscarriage, and then my
went
parents
somewhere?
Went to a
like a curandera.
Yeah.
And then, so, that's when they had you?
Yeah, that's when they had me.
Okay, here. Okay. Say in Jesus' name, I renounce.
And I went to, like, living life, I talked to psychics. Like about love and stuff.
Okay. Okay. All that was an open door. Hallelujah. Praise God. We're gonna break those legal entries, those legal rights that the enemy had. We're gonna break that bondage. But just say this, say in Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
I forgive my mother for what she did. I bless my mom. I pray for my mom. I release that situation to the cross. In Jesus' name. I renounce the contract that my mother made with Satan.
I renounce the contract my mother made
that led to my birth.
By the blood of Jesus.
That contract has ended and is destroyed tonight in Jesus' name. I apply the blood of Jesus to the circumstance of visiting psychic. I renounce. Say this. I renounce the authority that I gave Satan when I visited a warlock, when I visited a psychic. I renounce the contract that I went into, the spiritual contract with Satan, out of ignorance. Father, by the shed blood from the cross, by your word, by your love, by your power, we close that door. By the kingdom, I close the door on evil spirits that had a legal entry into my soul. I renounce the unclean spirits behind that psychic,
behind
that warlock.
Behind that warlock.
I forgive those people.
I forgive those people.
I release them by the fire of God.
I release them by the fire of God.
Satan, you hear me.
Satan, you hear me.
You know you've lost your authority.
You know you've lost your authority.
You know you are defeated.
You know you are defeated.
I have traveled to Phoenix.
I have traveled to Phoenix.
For the children's bread.
For the children's bread.
And by faith.
And by faith.
I receive it now.
I receive it now.
You unclean devils.
You unclean devils.
Come out of me.
Come out of me.
In Jesus' name.
Come out of me in Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Go ahead. Go in Jesus' name. You heard that, Satan? You lost your power. Come out of him now. In the name of Jesus, go. You warlock devil. You witchcraft devil. You unclean spirits. You curandera devils. Come out of them. Witchcraft. Come out of them in Jesus' name. Come out of them in Jesus' name. Go in the name of Jesus. Go in the name of Jesus. Go in the name of Jesus. Go in the name of Jesus Christ. Come out of them now. 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 There you go. Come out of them now. Satan, I hate you, devil. Come out now. You have no rights.
You
cannot stay.
Come out in Jesus.
You cannot stay.
You cannot stay in the name of Jesus. You cannot stay in Jesus' name.
Doing great. What's your name?
Patrick.
Doing fantastic. Keep going. Keep going. You're burping. They're being dislodged in the name of Jesus by the grace of God. As a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ, you listen to me. You unclean devil, you release him right now. You come out of him right now. You have no right to stay. You cannot stay anymore. I charge you, you stubborn devil. Come out of him now by the fire of God. Go in Jesus' name. Go in Jesus' name. Out. Come out of him now in Jesus' name. Come out of his life. Come out of his soul right now in the name of Jesus Christ. Go! Go in Jesus' name! Go in Jesus' name! Go in Jesus' name! Go in Jesus' name! Go in the name of Jesus Christ! Give me a good cough or a yawn. Out! I'm out of them right now. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, devil, you cannot stay. You cannot hide. In Jesus' name, we will not be denied. You come out of him now on the authority of the Word of God. By the death and resurrection of Jesus, I say go. I say go right now. I say go in Jesus' mighty name. Thank you, Lord.